Revolution Radio proudly presents, live from Phoenix, Arizona, the Truth Deny Talk Radio with host Roxy Lopez. Join us here for topics you won't hear about on mainstream news, such as chemtrails, GMOs, nutrition, and conspiracy facts regarding your personal sovereignty. Humanity is 7 billion strong. We are the majority. And now, live from the Valley of the Sun, your host, Roxy Lopez. And hey, here we are on Friday, July 12th. See, gosh, it's going by too fast, people. And you're listening to The Truth Denied. And of course, I am Roxy Lopez. I want to thank everybody. Oh, yes. Hello, chat room. Thomas reminded me that I never go in the chat room, and I did bounce into the chat room the other day, and you guys were also warm and fuzzy and loving, so thanks for having me in there for a little bit. But and hello, and if you have any questions for the guests, we'll open up the phone lines on the second hour, or you can just put your questions in the chat room, and you know, we'll bring them into the guests tonight. Also, I'll give you updates another time. This is a very important show. I don't want to take up any of my guests' time, but I'll give you updates on NOAA another time, or on the website. And I want to thank all the loving people who have written, called, just for support, you know, spiritual support, any kind of support. I'm glad I said something about it on Tuesday, and I just want to thank you all for being so loving. And you know, this is what it's all about. This is the part of the unification process that we're all going through, and we have things, I am sure of it, in our lives that cause us to have to reach out, because I'm very stubborn. You know, I'm at the, you know, I got to a place of complete emotional, physical exhaustion and intellectual exhaustion. And just by the time I had to express my feelings on the show, I could not keep it together. And that's why I fell apart. So I'm so glad I reached out to you, all of you listeners. Hello, listeners. And I want to thank all of the wonderful people who have been offering all types of solutions. So I'll leave it at that. And just know that I love you, and I appreciate your genuine, authentic caring that you have done. It all works. My guest this evening, one of my favorite people, Alfred Lambremont Webre. We're really going to cover some stuff. There's a lot of whistleblowing going on, and as I told all of you, shared with you on another show, August, my month of August is just booked with whistleblowers, and it's blowing my mind. As a matter of fact, Alfred and I chatted about that just a little bit before the show, that they're just coming out of the woodwork. So something is transcending, transpiring, getting transparent on this planet. And it's a beautiful thing. And it's shocking to some people who are not in the know. We're going to cover some topics that are really hard to discuss. And I'm glad that Alfred is the one that is bringing these topics to the forefront. We're going to get into transhumanism. We're going to get into Johnsville Centrifuge secret meeting and the list of attendees that explored environmental war alert at Calgary. Oh gosh, the list goes on and on. Stories that are just exploding, whistleblowers that are coming forward, the UFO ET citizen hearing with Steve Bassett and Greer. We're going to talk about some of this, but like I said, we're going to show you, or Alfred's going to show you exactly why this is all occurring in these areas of ufology and you name it, and what transhumanism is, how to spot it, etc. So without any further ado, you know, Alfred from exopolitics.com will be dropping some links in for you that are relative to the conversation this evening. Alfred, you're a busy man, so thanks so much for joining the show this evening, and we look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Well, thank you very much, Roxy. And I've been following the transhumanist agenda now, most folk, well, actually for about 40 years, but in its most recent focus, since I did I interviewed a panel of experts from Europe, from the European Union, on the transhumanist agenda and the recent scalar technologies that are now being applied. And most people think, or some people might think, that the transhumanist agenda is that they create advanced robots and the robots take over. And that's not what it is. The transhumanist agenda is an agenda to robotize humans and to have the robotized humans under the control of the powers that be, under the control of controllers, and to be, in essence, a mind-controlled slave population that are robotized, that are controlled through nano-implant technologies and through super nano-computers in a nano-cloud, and connected to a super grid of over 1,000 grids, including the electricity grid that we're all part of on the planet, that is in turn connected to HAARP. And these are actual things that are occurring now. And the function of chemtrails, we are discovering, and their role in the transhumanist agenda, is that, among other things, chemtrails contain tiny bots, nanobots, that populations, that the urban population, or, you know, people breathe in, and they're actually breathing in implants, nanobots, nano implants that get into the bloodstream and then jump the blood-brain barrier. And once in the brain, then become entrained and start emitting RF frequencies. And with that, become entrained with the super nano computers into the super grids. And one is on the way to becoming a robotized human and trained into the robotic grids of the transhumanist agenda. And they're at recent tests that occurred in Europe by this group, whose website is eucach.org, over 40% of the public that turned up to be tested were emitting RF frequencies, which means that they already had their brains entrained. They had already breathed in either nanobot implants through chemtrails, or or they had given their DNA. Their DNA was on file, and all that the transhumanist agenda, this technology, needs is your DNA, which can be gotten from any blood sample. If you give blood for a medical test, your blood then goes into the DNA sample bank and into the transhumanist surveillance banks, because what the DNA is a frequency, and all that's needed to entrain you into these scalar systems is a frequency. It's not like the old days with mind control, where they would have electromagnetics that you could shield yourself from with lead helmets or something like that. No, and this is scalar, and scalar is point to point. It goes direct from the emitter direct to your brain, and it travels in subspace at higher than the speed of light. So we're dealing with that sort of thing. And the transhumanist agenda at the dimensional level can be in implementation of a dark force agenda in terms of dimensional extraterrestrials. Thankfully, the dimensional extraterrestrials, at least by some evidence, are being driven off of the planet and are not achieving their aim of occupying the planet. These are the Draco reptilians and certain species of greys. There are over 150 species of greys, and there's a very narrow set of alliances between some species of greys and reptilians that had set up an exopolitical alliance to take over planets in this quadrant of the galaxy, including our Earth and Mars. But it looks like the upper dimensional extraterrestrials are beating them back. So what we're doing is fighting a being part of a multi-dimensional Star Wars, as it were. Excuse me, I'm just going to take a sip of green tea here.
Go ahead, Alfred. You know, while you're doing that, this agenda called the Transhumanist Agenda, for anybody who's new to this terminology, my question would be, those who are doing the chemtrails and have these, you know, nanobots, and people are obviously breathing them, and then, like you said, it's also proven that there are many diseases cropping up that are breaking the blood-brain barrier like never before, and new types of diseases like Morgellons, let's say, or people getting animal diseases when, you know, animals are not contagious to humans, etc. So whose agenda, just briefly, Alfred, is this clearly a ET agenda that you were talking about, all the 150 different types of greys and so forth in the reptilians, working with some very dark humans combined in this agenda? Or is it just ET agenda and they've got us by the you-know-what and making us do this, making humans do this?
Yeah, this is a very those are key questions, and we're still exploring all of the issues raised by those questions. And it appears that if you go into Morgellons, for example, there do appear to be extraterrestrial elements to Morgellons. Now, having said that, this group, EUCACH.org, and anyone who has Morgellons can contact them, or people who are interested in this, because as a result of a lot of the attention that has been drawn to them over the last several months, because of the contextualization of Morgellons, of these new mind control, scalar mind control technologies in the context of the transhumanist agenda, there is now an e-clinic which is beginning to successfully treat Morgellons. And so what we're doing is to beginning to gather clinicians that are working with the targeted individuals who have been targeted by these scalar technologies, who then have the Morgellons come up, and they're typically targeting mothers with children. And so their husbands freak out and attempt to get their wives
committed.
Yes. Mm-hmm. EUCACH, which is headquartered in Brussels, has a lot of experience with this, but now they've added a clinical component, which is beginning to treat this. They've gotten a lot of advanced scientific techniques so such that it is beating back all of the lies that are put out there that, that just say, oh, this is nothing. This is just your imagination. So this seems to be an area where, because of the EU, once a week, the European Parliament allows outside groups, citizen groups, to come in and meet with the parliamentarians. And so the parliamentarians there are now being exposed to a lot of literature. For example, DVDs were made of the panel interview that we were able to do with the panel of experts, and that was given out to all the key members of the European Union. And now the European Union has invited them to come and testify before a key panel there, before a key committee seeking to put a ban on these technologies. So, EUCACH is now doing an outreach both to Canadian TIs and to American TIs as well, because it looks like we're getting some traction there in this issue. I've been following this issue now for 40 years because I was targeted by electromagnetic weapons in Washington, D.C. at the inner ring of the Pentagon October of 1977, when I was director of the Carter White House Extraterrestrial Communication Study. I was targeted by intelligence agents of the Pentagon as I was meeting with an Assistant Secretary of Defense at the inner ring of the Pentagon in October of 1977. So I've been an activist in this area, and it looks like we're starting to get some traction in the EU because it's not as shut down as the Parliament and the Congress in North America. The Congress of the US and the Canadian Parliament are all shut down on this issue because most of the Congress people and the Canadian parliamentarians are under mind control themselves, in my humble opinion. So now to get, so what we've done then, starting with this experience about 2 or 3 months ago, where we were able to look, and with the help of these experts, into this new generation of scalar technologies and this agenda. What we did is to apply these insights to the UFO and ET field, because there's certain species of UFO, of extraterrestrials, in the reptilian and gray quadrant. Not the majority of reptilians, not the majority of grays, but certain rogue alliances that have gone into a treaty process, a secret treaty and agreement process with the U.S. government and with the New World Order, such that the rollout of the New World Order on this planet is, in effect, the rollout of this, or of this Draco-Reptilian and Orion Gray agenda in 3D, because they can't act in 3D. Humans act in 3D, although they're trying to generate hybrids that will act out their agenda in 3D now. So that brings us to two cases that, from exopolitical analysis, we were able to do just over the last several months. And one of them had to do with a secret meeting of leading UFO and ET analysts that was called in November of 2012 on the site of the Johnsville Centrifuge. Now, the Johnsville Centrifuge was part of the Naval Air Warfare Center at Warminster, Pennsylvania. I didn't even know there was a place called Warminster, Pennsylvania. which played an important part in Project Mercury, since there at Johnsville possessed the world's largest centrifuge capable of spinning a man or woman to 16G. So it was like astronaut training. But underneath the Naval Air Warfare Center, according to at least one source, and this is the psychic clairvoyant Anya Briggs, who herself, her father was a, her grandfather, Herbert W. Briggs, is a very famous international law professor, author of The Law of Nations. I studied his books as a law student. And her other grandfather was a physician who lived outside of an Air Force base in Ohio and was asked to come in and treat the Project Paperclip scientists right after World War II and perhaps other ET types that were there on the base as well. So there's a whole dark agenda. She's had a multi-generational connection on one of the grandfather's side where this was known in the family as to having this particular knowledge. Now, it turns out that in June of 2012, and I put all of these documents because this is a secret meeting at which all of the attendees were required to sign non-disclosure agreements. This is kind of like the Bilderberger meeting, but supposedly of light workers, quote, end of quote, where moneyed sources invite, quote, end of quote, light workers and UFO and extraterrestrial researchers to come to the site of the Naval Air War Center in Warminster, Pennsylvania, to a secret meeting where they have to sign all of these.
Yeah, that's really concerning. And you know, I do want to get a little bit into that, you know, show the layout here, of course. I watched the interview. I just put a couple of links into the chat room for everyone to take a look at it. We're going to take a quick break here in a second, Alfred, so I don't want to interrupt you when you start to explain the rest of that story. But what I did watch the interview that you had with Anya Briggs, and, you know, it really blew my mind. As a matter of fact, what she was exploring and sort of just putting out there to the public with the interview, by the way, thank you for doing that interview because it really enlightened me. But, you know, I must say it blew my mind. And what blew my mind even more was who was on the list. And I almost couldn't believe it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. This was a targeting, an apparent targeting of leading UFO.
And so, Alfred, the guests were targeted. Who was in charge of putting the secret meeting at the Johnsville Centrifuge together? And what was the meeting supposed to be about that all these UFO researchers and, you know, had to go in and sign a non-disclosure agreement, as you said, and then on top of it, can't come out and talk about what the meeting was all about? Who put the meeting on?
Well, you see, this is where people can get manipulated from dimensional, bi-dimensional influences. That is, if certain people are either programmed multiples, or they have implants, or they are under the mind control of negative ETs, they are, or into some certain circuits, they can get manipulated and influenced to play out certain agendas. And In this case, what I did is when I was contacted, I did due diligence at the same time. And so what happened to me is that on July 13th, 2012, and I kept very careful records and all the documentations as a reporter, I was invited by the host to the special meeting, all expenses paid. It was, you know, oh, you're going to love the food. You know, this is a great thing at this exclusive place. And the host, Larry Frischella, got on the phone with me and said, look, I made a lot of money in the subprime mortgage business, and I intend to invite the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff to this meeting, you know, of the U.S. Joint Chiefs of Staff. And I was going, what? What is this all about? You know, on a former naval war base. So I was kind of like, you know, around. Then I did due diligence on this. I spoke to him 5 days after I received, or 4 days after I received the invitation on July 17th, 2012, which is when he told me that he intended to invite the chairman of the U.S. Joint Chiefs of Staff, and that he was going to invite the creme de la creme of the ET and the UFO research community. Then I did due diligence on him, and I discovered a bunch of, you know, these lawsuits on the internet. And I discovered that he and his twin brother, David, owned Frischella Enterprises, doing business with Cash Today. And that, in fact, they were a payday lending business that had gone bankrupt. And in December 2005, a class of consumers bought claims in the Court of Common Pleas of Philadelphia County against Frischella Enterprise and his principals, David and Larry Frischella, are alleging violations of state usury and consumer protection laws. So these guys were fleecing the public, right?
Okay.
So you don't know who's behind this meeting.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, these are shady characters.
Yeah, sure, sure. And but then it even gets deeper and more concerning as some of the folks on the list were disclosed. You know, I mean, you've got like some pretty big people, Stephen Bassett, apparently, Carrie Cassidy.
Go ahead.
But that's even more alarming because it does. Go ahead, Alfred, because it gets really deep.
So then, for some reason, 2 weeks later, 2 weeks after I do the due diligence, I get an email from Larry Frischella saying on July 30, 2012, regretfully, it has come to my attention that due to unforeseen issues, I find myself in the position that I have to hereby rescind your invitation to the event in November. Now, is that a sleazeball email or what?
Yeah, I read what your on your link. Yeah, it is.
I have been in legal practice for 45 years. That is a sleazeball sentence,
right?
If I've ever seen one.
Right.
So, I mean, these are shady characters operating at Warminster, Pennsylvania, on top of this naval air base where Anya Briggs, who's a good psychic, has picked up that there are gray and reptilian bases underneath that, and that there's all this stuff going on, you know, all this mind control stuff. So at that point, I personally lose touch with it, right? July 30th, 2012. And I often wondered what was going on. And so then I fast forward and I see that Anya had been invited herself, and then through or was kind of like in a was a prime alternate through a friend of hers, and then at the last minute could not go. So I think we were both blessed by not going to this event. And I wonder what the mechanism was that I was canceled. I really wonder.
Right.
So, but a partial list of the attendees there are Micah Hance, Anthony Sachin, Scotty Roberts, Stephen Bassett, Carrie Cassidy, Miriam Delicato, Chip Coffey, Leo Sprinkles, Mel Fabregas, Stanton Friedman, Kim Carlsberg, John Alexander, and David Wilcock. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Apparently David arrived in a limo and held court during the whole thing, which is, you know. Now, what the evidence that came out of this were two things. Number one, at the conscious level, what was emphasized, and this is from testimonies of various of the people there who were texting and calling to Anya and telling her what was going on, and from conversations that I had independently with my sources who were there, who also have a complete list of the people who were there. And the people that I read off are just a partial list, okay?
Yes.
A partial list of the people that were there. And at the conscious level, what was emphasized was that these are great gourmet meals and drink. And there was a lot of liquor. There was a lot of drinking. There was a lot of eating and a lot of, you know, just a lot of alcohol. You follow me?
Yeah.
And what Anya says is that in the night shift, you know, we have, let's say we're in the day shift now, and at night we go into the night shift. We go asleep and we go into the astral. We go into the adjacent dimensions.
Yes.
Some people call it the night shift. It's just real, real simple to say the day shift and the night shift. During the night shift, certain of the key people there were, shall we call it, abducted. And I contacted additional sources in addition to Anya, who themselves confirmed this.
When you say abducted, what do you mean by abducted?
Okay. It means that, okay, if you begin to examine the literature of alien abduction, it does not mean only that your body is abducted. It can mean what they call an out-of-body experience. It can mean that your soul is abducted, or your mind and soul are abducted. Your etheric body, which contains your soul, okay? If you don't have a powerful soul, if your soul is drinking a lot of liquor, who knows what was in some of that liquor, right?
Right. You know, okay, my other question then, yeah, I get your drift. I just wanted to be clear.
But to complete the affirmative statement here, that a number of the key people there and the people that were mentioned explicitly were Stephen Bassett and Carrie Cassidy, among others, were abducted that night and were essentially mind controlled or brainwashed by the Greys. It could have been a MyLab. A MyLab is called a military abduction. And this is where the Greys and the US military are working together to do abductions. And they have a joint abduction technology, which then they work extreme mind control. And then they brainwash them with the extraterrestrial, with the Grey agenda, okay? Which distorts your perception because it blunts you as a truth seeker. It makes your research agenda follow all the cover-ups that the Greys want. Okay? So that essentially is the story that emerged out of the Johnsville Centrifuge. And it's a story of how the transhumanist agenda, turning humans into robots, may have been played out at the November 2012 Johnsville Centrifuge meeting. And all those people, Kerry Cassidy, Stephen Bassett, Stanton Friedman, John Alexander, David Wilcock, have signed non-disclosure agreements so they can't talk about it. And they're supposed to be truth movement journalists. So they got whacked and whammied, and they got trapped by dimensional mind control agents, according to informed investigative psychics. Okay.
Oh, okay. And just to ask something real quick here. Yeah. Are the guests that are on this list?
Yeah.
You know, those that we're talking about right now, are those guests aware of A, that there's been an exposure to this now, and B, have you, Anya Briggs, or any other reporters spoken to any of the guests like Kerry Cassidy or Bassett about this at all?
Okay. I have personally spoken to guests at the party. They say that all that happened was a lot of drinking and eating, and that they do not believe that they were abducted. But the guests that I spoke to left early. Okay?
Okay.
And I did not speak to Stephen Bassett, and I are not on speaking terms. And I have not spoken to Kerry Cassidy about this. And I asked those explicit questions to Anya Briggs, who is a psychic who discovered this, and she said that they're not aware that they were abducted because their memories have been blocked. And I checked that with a second person who is a known psychic, and there was confirmation of that happening, that something did happen that night of that nature.
What was the intention, just to fill in the blanks here for the listening audience, what was the original intention of the secret meeting that these people were invited to? Just, yeah. You know, in brief, just to recap.
Okay, Joe, in brief. I'm going to read from their invitation. This would be, and I'm reading from their invitation of July 13, 2012. This would be an all-expense-paid weekend, inclusive travel and hotel, VIP personalized service, and wonderful meals. Meals will comprise a special VIP welcome dinner, incredible brunch at the home of the host, an amazing dinner party symposium at the original Johnsville Centrifuge, the largest and most powerful centrifuge the world has ever seen, where everyone who ever stepped on the moon trained. No marketing, no hype. Just a chance to be part of something down to earth, orchestrated to try to better understand the universal questions and how to apply the questions of the universe to answer the many questions stemming from our knowledge of them and their impact of them. Now, if there's everything so innocent, why do you have to sign a non-disclosure agreement?
Well, and why is it secret? So, yeah. And you even said in the invite, you know, at the expense, all expenses paid, and some of the meals at the home of the host of the whole thing. This, in your 45 years of reporting, have you ever seen anything quite like this?
Well, this is like a Bilderberger thing.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
You know, and the intent of the host when he spoke to me was that he was going to bring in the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. So my guess is that when he spoke to people, you know, it was bait and switch, right? Oh, you're going to get to meet the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and you're going to get to say, hey, chairman, why don't you disclose, right? So it was bait and switch to get all of these people there. It was done by somebody who said, oh, I made a lot of money in the subprime mortgage area. Baloney. He made a lot of money in fleece the consumers area. Okay? Mm-hmm. Which we can show through the class action lawsuits against him. So he was a shady character. He probably was either being directly employed or manipulated by others to get this gathering happening on top of this gray ET in this military base. I mean, it's just like, it's like a no-brainer. And what comes out of that? Okay. What comes out of that is Steve Bassett. Now, Steve Bassett goes on then to organize the next April and May 2013, the citizen hearing.
Right.
Now, that's where we get to the second part of the puzzle. And that is where we were able to study the brain. We did a study of brain mind entrainment, either by manipulatory extraterrestrials or advanced military intelligence nanotechnology as part of a global control agenda. And again, people can go to exopolitics.com to see the evidence. And what we did is we got the videos. We got these videos from four witnesses. And the four witnesses are Stephen Bassett, Antonio Huneeus, who was there, and Dr. Stephen Greer. And we show these anomalous eye movements, which are all evidence of mind, brain, entrainment. It's like when you've been chipped, when you have a nano chip and they're running you, that's what happens to your eyes. That's what happens to your body parts. And we just show that as they're testifying in other areas. And we make the correlations between that and what happens at the hearing. Now, what happens there? What happens is that a lawyer from Vancouver, BC, gives $1 million out of the blue to Stephen Bassett, and Stephen Bassett in turn brings in 40 witnesses. Who does he bring in? Mainly 40 researchers. Does not bring in any whistleblowers from secret U.S. ET visitation programs or from planetary visitation programs, that is, U.S. programs to visit other planets, whistleblowers who have been on other planets, or whistleblowers who have interacted with extraterrestrials, or does not bring in any exopoliticians who have developed theories about this. In fact, all of the witnesses that we show, Stephen Bassett, Antonio Huneeus, and Dr. Stephen Greer, get on there. They're each promoting a policy of, quote, self-disclosure by the U.S. government of an extraterrestrial presence without any informed consent from the citizenry, such as a national or world referendum. It's like, ETs, come, ETs, you know, without any consent. This is a top-down thing without any consent. It's like, give us blanket consent, right? And these are individuals, Stephen Bassett, Antonio Huneeus, and Stephen Greer, who are opinion leaders in this community, who were handpicked by one person, Bassett, who was at this meeting in the Johnsville Centrifuge, who was abducted and brainwashed by the Greys, and who then picks only people who, when the senator and the congresspeople ask them, well, who are these ETs and what are their aims? Everybody, all 40 of them, says, we don't know and we can't tell you. And that's because they intentionally picked 40 people who don't know, rather than picking people from the exopolitical community, which I could have brought 20 people to the table who can answer all those questions. And 10 years ago, in 2003, I co-wrote the proposal for the citizen hearing with Stephen Bassett. It was on the website for 10 years of the citizen hearing from 2003 forward that Alfred Webre and Stephen Bassett wrote it together. So I was entitled to 20 witnesses out of the 40 that were brought. And the lawyer here in Vancouver who gave the $1 million lives about 10 blocks from me here, 10 blocks from where I'm talking to you right now. He called me up about 6 weeks ago and said, oh, I want to meet you. And I said, fine. And the day that I asked him over to my house for tea, and his name is Clearwater, Tom Clearwater. And I asked him over to my house for tea. I said, yeah, I'll serve you tea. And the morning that on the day that he was supposed to come, about 2 hours before he's to come, he sent me an email saying, I've read your articles on the citizen hearing, what I'm just explaining to you now about the anomalous eye moves, and I don't agree with you. And so I wrote back to him and I said, as a lawyer, how could you give $1 million without doing due diligence? That isn't grantsmanship. You know, I oversaw the public interest environmental law movement, that is National Resources Defense Council and the Environmental Defense Fund for the Ford Foundation, so that they, all their grants, this is to enforce environmental laws, their principles of grantsmanship, you have to do due diligence. And this lawyer gave them $1 million without doing any due diligence, that our proposal had been up there for 10 years and that I had co-written it with my name on it. So I was entitled to 50% of those witnesses, or 20 people who would have come in with witnesses that weren't on the gray reptilian agenda. So I'm being as clear as I can here to show you how practically the public and the Congress and the media are being brainwashed. Because that $1 million was then used in the National Press Club to generate a whole bunch of MSNBC and, you know, other Today Show.
And if you're just joining us, the guest this evening, oh my goodness, Alfred Lambremont Webre, really exposing, making something that most of you don't know anything about, most of us don't know anything about. Alfred, I have a quick question for you in continuing this $1 million given to Bassett and these 40 individual, these 40 witnesses. I have a question for you. The Disclosure Project press conference that happened May 9th, 2001, where over 20 military, intelligent, government, corporate, and scientific witnesses came forward at the National Press Club in Washington, D.C., are any of those individuals, you know, to really, they were there to establish the reality of UFOs or extraterrestrial vehicles, all of it, expose all of it. Are any of those individuals on this 40 witnesses that they're going to be doing this new disclosure project?
Well, there are a few of them. Dr. Greer was one, and he is prime suspect number one, because we showed through forensic evidence that he's displaying the anomalous eye movements that suggest that he's under brain mind entrainment, either of advanced scalar nanotechnology and or both manipulatory ETs. So it's like all the people that have been carried over are the people that are under entrainment. And those people that were excluded, such as myself, if you go back to the Disclosure Project press conference of May 9th, 2001, if you look at the press releases of that day, they were released under two names, the joint names of Dr. Stephen Greer and Alfred Lambremont Webre. And you can go to exopolitics.com and the historical documents are there. And it was a collective of us that put together the Disclosure Project press conference, including Dr. Cal Rosin and many other people.
Oh, the list goes on and on. Astronaut Gordon Cooper, Nick Pope, all of them.
Yeah. So it was not a single individual. I mean, organizationally.
Yeah.
People gave the money. I put together spoke to the international media. We all did the organization, and my name was on, together with Greer, the press releases, such that the message that I was carrying at that point, which is from a different sector of extraterrestrials, which are from the advanced human ethical ETs, and from the whistleblowers from secret human extraterrestrial liaison programs, like the secret Mars programs, that have been, interacting with Martian astronauts for the last 30, 40 years, since the mid 70s. And instead of having whistleblowers at the table who said, yeah, the CIA has been interacting with Martian astronauts since the mid 1970s, and this is what they're like, and this is what the Martian civilization does, and getting some real knowledge about it, and having a reunion and a rapprochement between the human race of Earth and the human race of Mars that have been separated for 11,500 years since the solar system catastrophe of 9500 BC. What the Bassett organization did, because he's under gray ET, he's under negative gray ET mind control, was to continue the meme that, oh, there are lights in the sky, and we don't know anything about them, and we don't know what they do.
Right.
You know, and that goes back to the Disclosure Project press conference. You see, where there have been two camps in there. Those who are teleguided and who are under the mind control of the grays, and those of us who are humans and who are really with the human ETs, with the Pleiadians, the Alpha Centaurians, the Sirians, the earthly humans, the Martian humans, all of that.
You know, my concern, Alfred, my concern with this is that this, you know, getting back to what happened this past December at the Centrifuge, you know, with the secret meeting and the list of those individuals, they've taken some great individuals, and if this is the case, and brainwashed, this is going to split the movement up into toilet paper, shredded toilet paper.
Well,
As far as any factual anything, if these people are all mind controlled, I mean, Greer just came out with the movie Sirius. Now you got Bassett, which is, you know, by the way, I want to address something real quickly, Alfred, to the listeners. Yeah. You know, even Coast to Coast is talking about this. Everyone is upside down, turning upside down and saying, what the heck is going on? Because once that kind of money, in 45 years, have you ever seen any one institution be given $1 million to do a documentary?
No. And
especially about UFO disclosure.
Yeah. And being given $1 million in a way that you exclude the co-author of the proposal.
Right.
Right. I mean, that blows my mind. There's a proposal that for 10 years.
Now, why would that happen? Was there, you know, I just have to ask you, Alfred, and I already know pretty much what you're going to say, but you had a good relationship with Bassett for quite some time. So there would be no reason for him to just cut you out of the loop, would there?
I think that there may have been irritants on his side. Mm-hmm. One irritant was that I publicly spoke out in support of a fellow crop circle researcher named Suzanne Taylor.
Yes.
And that may have been an irritant, but you can't go against the ethics of fundraising and $1 million just because of that, number one. More seriously, this goes to the whole issue of my championing the issue of life on Mars. I mean, a quarter of my book, Exopolitics, is on life on Mars. And I was the first person to publish interviews with a Mars whistleblower, starting with Andrew DiBasciago, Laura Eisenhower, William Brett Stillings, Bernard Mendez, all of the people that have come forward from the Mars, life on Mars programs. I was the first person to do that. And I, you know, and by doing that, there was a whole sector led by Bassett that shunned me. And that's part of the CIA program, part of the program of keeping all of that secret, because the U.S. wants to occupy Mars as the 51st state, but they want to do it in secret, is to stigmatize any whistleblowing around Mars and to stigmatize journalists like myself and exopoliticians who come out with that truth. So Bassett has always been playing for the dark side, for the CIA and for the government, by bashing me for coming out on life on Mars. And that's the deeper issue. It was Mars. It was because of my championing of life on Mars that he felt that he could ethically break the joint proposal on the citizen hearing and just run off with the $1 million. And when I wrote the lawyer here and I said, how could you, Tom Clearwater, as a member of the Bar of British Columbia, not exercise due diligence and give $1 million to a person who you know did this, I haven't received a reply yet. They can't reply. They don't have a reply because they know that they've done something that's ethical and that's not right, that's wrong, that's a cover-up. They're playing for the wrong side. And that's what's happening now. There are two dimensions that are happening. There's the dimension of the opening up of the truth of the whistleblowing, and there's the dimension of the old order. And these guys are going for the dimension of illusionary power and the old order, you know? And that lawyer with $1 million bought into the old order. And that's all that I see here, because all that they did was to put $1 million behind an antiquated view of what one faction of the Greys and the Reptilians want the world to think what extraterrestrials are.
Right. And I think it just does such a disservice. You know, there are so many people as well in relationship to UFO disclosure that live in D.C., other ufologists, other people who have footage, who have been working on this exposure for quite some time, who live blocks from Mr. Bassett. And they called me. They've been on the show. They've been on coast to coast. You know, they're very well-known individuals. And they called me and they said, after a certain point, they're throwing their hands up too and saying, what the heck is going on here? You know, George Norrie's guest, one after the other, in relationship to UFO disclosure, saying, what the heck's going on here? And the writing was on the wall as well when he, you know, was with the We the People website and never could get, you know, the 20,000 or whatever it was signatures when it was a global, you know, when I had him on the show, I asked him, who can sign, you know, that on the We the People disclosure project, 1, 2, 3, and whatever, who could, it was global. And they only had 5,000 or 6,000, and we know the rest of the story. We don't have to get in there. That's too much of a diversion. But it was interesting because how could we, you know, with worldwide everyone wanting to know about disclosure, how come nobody wanted to sign that petition with million, you know, 7 billion people in the world or over 7 billion people? So it's interesting, you know, and I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to be straightforward with you. He approached me, and I've got him coming on the show August 13, Alfred.
Well, you can begin to ask him straight questions now.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Now, I am sure that he's going to have his own answers, but the data that I stand behind, all the data that we have produced at exopolitics.com, and you have the links to all of those articles.
I sure do. I sure do.
And, you know, Our assertions stand, I believe.
I like what you said, Alfred, when you said there's two types right now. And really what it is in a big picture is the people who are buying into the old paradigm and the people who are doing the new paradigm. And it's very difficult because I appreciate what you do, Alfred, as a whistleblower. Like I said, it is unbelievable how many whistleblowers are coming forward, even to us, you know, saying, I need a place to tell the truth of what is going on, from anywhere from fracking to insiders in the government, not just UFO stuff either. So I appreciate what you're doing because you took a stance, you have been taking a stance, and listeners, if you're new to Alfred Webre, let me tell you something. Click these links and look at the in-depth reporting that Alfred does, and you will become a fan. One thing that I love about you, Alfred, is you don't surmise and you don't opinionize. You actually go out there and get the facts. So I appreciate that, and I'm sure my listeners do as well.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very
credible. You're very welcome. You're a very credible individual, and you have been for quite some time. So onward, and I hear the passion in your voice, because what else is there to do with this situation but to bring it forward? And Alfred, some of these people that were at the centrifuge meeting, the private secret meeting in December 2012, some of these people are colleagues and people that you've known for years.
Yes, yes.
The guests. The guests.
And yes, yes. And the ones that I've spoken to about it, who are open to me about it, say, look, it was just a big schmooze party. And people were drinking a lot and they were blowing their horn a lot, you know. Mm-hmm. And but they left early. What Anya Briggs told me is that she had sources who were texting her and calling her on their cell phones from the party because she was doing an investigation of it because she had gotten all the psychic hits that there was something going on underneath the base in terms of dimensional interference by grays. From that point of view, it was a setup from a mind control point of view, that is to get people in their ego, to get them in their drink and unsuspecting, and then to abduct them at night. Now, as to which targeted individuals were abducted and which weren't, the only ones that Anya did mention were two, and that was Steve Bassett and Carrie Cassidy. Now, there are many, many people who were there, and I don't have information.
Are you saying that those two for sure were abducted? Is that what you're saying?
I'm saying two things.
Okay.
I'm saying that the psychic source that I have, Anya Briggs, who has a lot of credible information on this and who, like myself, was invited to the meeting and who did not go, and who published a whistleblowing article on it, stated that there were a number of individuals there who were abducted at night, either in a, you know, either their not their physical bodies, but their mental bodies were abducted, or perhaps their physical. I don't know how, you know.
Yes.
And the two that she did mention in the interview were Steve Bassett and Carrie Cassidy. And I consulted a second source, and who said, and did not mention names, but said that, yes, there was a mind control element that went on that night. It could have been my lab that is mixed U.S. military with ET or straight ET. Because you don't hold a light workers meeting at the Naval Air War.
Yeah, that's just wacky.
Westminster, Pennsylvania. You don't hold a light workers meeting over that. I mean, it's whacked. It's totally incongruous.
Sure it
and
is.
Held it over a gray ET and Draco reptilian bases under there, according to Tanya Briggs. So I'm using exopolitical reporting here. And if people want to read my book, it's now out in Kindle. It's on Kindle. So it's an ebook. You can just download it right to your
desk. What's it called, Alfred?
It's called Exopolitics, Politics, Government, and Law in the Universe. You just go to exopolitics.com and click there. It'll take you right to Kindle. And you can have it. It lists the 14 or 15 different sources that we use in exopolitics, and it includes dimensional sources, that way you can use reliable dimensional psychic sources for exopolitics. And here I believe that I've achieved a reliable set of configurations that are cross-checked and congruent with the reporting that we did with the anomalous eye movements, which showed that these individuals were in fact brain, mind, and trained.
And what do you do with this information now, Alfred, moving forward? Is this going to put the exopolitical movement in danger?
No. I feel okay. Like sheriff. Look, I've been doing this since
1973. The sheriff.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
I've been doing this since 1973. This is my 40th year. And my intention is to clean up the act, to clean up the saloon, okay?
Right.
To clean up the field. We've had enough charlatanism. We've had enough infiltration of the movement by people who are brain and mind entrained, either by government, U.S. government, mind control, by gray ET mind control, who are really, you know, have no moral center, a whole wide variety of things. And my intent in the remainder of 2013, and I sent this out very, very clearly, is to begin to expose these centers in an effort to clear out all of this. And starting in 2014, concurrently with this, to reinvigorate a new global agenda that is centered on exopolitics and a positive future, working with the positive, ethical, upper dimensional ETs. And at that time, I will have an announcement to make that'll have all the policies and the initiative and the platforms around which we'll go it over. But right now in 2013, it's like, okay, what was it? Shoot out the okay corral, and we're taking out the garbage, and we're exposing, and we're cleaning out the field.
What these individuals, Alfred, have been mind controlled, and a lot of people, the public, general public, follow all of these UFO and the likes, the list that you gave that attended the secret meeting and are friendly and colleagues, maybe even. I mean, it goes all the way around the block. I'm colleagues with some of them, friendly with some of them. What does the public do, though?
Yeah, I'm not issuing blanket judgments here.
No. My question is this. Yeah. Is the what use of this information? What is the public to think? What is the public to do? Is the public to be aware that this happened? And what? I mean, there's got to be sort of a solution, Alfred.
Yeah, what we're doing is we are making the public aware of the transhumanist agenda and the fact that it has been operating in the public sphere.
Right.
Okay. And we're giving people and the principals the opportunity to calibrate themselves, to really take a moment and reflect, to the Steve Bassett, to calibrate his actions. Now, at the same time, it's prophesized that at this time, there are two dimensions, two shall be working in the field. One shall be taken, one shall be left, brother shall fight against brother. There are two dimensions going on. One is a truth dimension and one is an illusory New World Order dimension. And that is stratification of a higher order that I do not control. But I am telling my truth and what I assume to be objective universal truth to the best that I can at a high frequency. And I believe that these frequencies are going to become more and more dominant, because this planet is on the verge of a global shift. And what will come out of this shift is in essence a paradise planet on a positive timeline. And that is the agenda and the timeline of the new era that I'm following. But for now, I'm just whistleblowing and calling out what I see.
And which is a great thing, and I certainly know that everyone listening appreciates that. I mean, it takes a lot of courage, Alfred, to do what you're doing. And hopefully there's a solving of the issues as you go along. Like you say, you're in the saloon and you're having a shoot 'em up, bang, bang, and who knows, maybe there could be a merging of ways. Brad Olson had mentioned on a show, he's going to be coming up here next week, I think. And he spoke about a merging of two timelines that is apparently happening roughly in August, and it's known as the event. Do you know anything about that, the merging of these two timelines?
Well, tell me more.
Well, that's all I really know, and I guess I'm going to I'll have to send you more information about it for sure. And it seemed like my audience knew what it was about. I personally had never heard of it before, known as the event, an event. I know for you, you've been on the show before and with Andrew Bishago talking about the catastrophic event and the what was the other one? There's two of them.
Well, there's a catastrophic timeline and right. there's positive timeline.
That's right. And you're on the positive timeline. So that's why you're doing back. Listen, if you want to call in the show, you got a question, or those of you in the chat room, if you have a question for Alfred, now would be the time to ask that question. And the call-in number is 347-688-2902. That's 347-688-2902, or Skype us at Freedom Screen. All right, and Alfred, what does this all mean in the really big picture? I heard a quote, and now I can't remember who it was from. It was in an article I was reading. I don't think it was one of yours, that said that was quoting Stephen Bassett after the citizens' hearing, and he had said to the public, this again, I'm sorry, I don't have the person's name, said to the public when he was asked about UFO disclosure, he said the government's already disclosed UFOs. They've given us all we've got through FOIA reports, and that's why, you know, hence he's going to do this 40 witnesses and all the rest of it. What do you think about this? What does UFO disclosure look like to you, and has the government already disclosed everything they know?
Well, in a certain way, the government has not, because the government has not disclosed the fact that there are extraterrestrials on the planet, that they've been working with extraterrestrials for 40 years, that extraterrestrials go back and forth on a daily basis, that there are extraterrestrials working in the military industrial complex, in the aerospace industry. You know, this is like hidden from the general public. And in a way, that's a tiny issue compared, if we shift all of a sudden to the more global issue. And this is what I like to talk about for this segment of
yes.
the program, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
And that is that we're now, especially coming up to 2014, in what we can begin to judge from congruent evidence from disparate sources of data of a coming global shift. And that coming global shift has been described as an awakening and transformation of human consciousness, dramatic changes in the way that human society functions, a breakdown of the old order and the emergence of a new way, a new, more humane way, civilization on planet Earth. There may be Earth changes accompanying it. It's not totally sure. The timeline that has been mentioned from divergent sources seems to culminate around the year 2017. Now, these dates are always moving targets. So let's say that that's the current date, right? Around the year 2017. Now, these are dates, on the one hand, from a consensus from over 2,000 cases of conscious interaction with crystal children who interact with extraterrestrials. And these crystal children are taken systematically on board the ships, either in the night shift in a bodily format or in, you know, out-of-body format for training. It's clear that there's several new species of humans that are evolving in a positive sense, not as part of the transhumanist agenda of control by an elite, but rather in a more capable human of 12-strand DNA, 24-strand DNA, developed chakra systems, much more consciousness, ability to interact on a multi-dimensional level, and that there's a transition that's happening with this very large event or happening coming but it's around 2017. So maybe that's what the event is like. It's not something that humans can plan. It's not like, oh, let's go out and create the event. It may be a culmination of things, so that those of us who have incarnated as star seeds here, either as early indigos, which I count myself in, now the figures range from between, I've heard from the experiment, from the reports, everything from 50% up to 85-90% of the incoming infants are star children. That is, they're all star kids who are coming in with, you know, enhanced auras, enhanced chakra system, enhanced DNA to be able to operate in this new 5D system that we're going to be in, and that may be landing now. You know, we're in the midst of a shift, and that shift may be accelerating, and such that around 2016, 2017, there's really a quantum leap. So I know that I spend most of my time getting my system up to speed as much as I can, so that, wow, let's see if I can handle 5D. And to be able to report what I'm seeing back and forth. Now, there seems to be, at the same time that the sort of the darker forces of the old order, which are splitting off into an alternative dimension where they can't seem to get out of, their response to change is to make war and to oppress. That's all that they know how to do. And for example, they just started weather warfare here in Canada, major weather warfare against Calgary and against Toronto in the last week of June, and again on July 4th and July 8th against Calgary and Toronto. And that's all proven. We have all of the evidence. Go to exopolitics.com. It seems like it's a globalist move. Again, the monarchies and the bloodline bankers are what's doing this. I call it the exploitative Anunnaki Illuminati hierarchy. And these are the remnants of the Anunnaki bloodlines that came down through the pharaohs and the coneheads. You know, they have these kind of conehead skulls that are the creators of all the monarchies, all the religions, and all the bankers, which are hereditary. They're these bloodlines, and they're trying to keep their gig going, but they're getting kicked. They can't make it in the new dimension. So it may be that the dimensions separate and they go to some other dimension, or they go to a subspace. They just kind of go to some other dimension where they have to incarnate a lot more. You know, we don't know what's going to happen, but it looks like we're coming to a shift in the game over the next 4 to 5 years. We've published two interviews and articles that I recommend to your readers. Go to exopolitics.com. One, look at the Mary Rodwell interview, where she's dealing with the results of her interactions with over 2,000 cases of crystal kids who interact with extraterrestrials, and what they're saying about the global shift that'll happen around 2017 and that's happening now. And then also with hermeneutics expert, this prophecy interpretation expert, Peter Kling, who sees a timeline from 2013 to 2007 as a key transition for humanity and Earth.
You mean 2017?
Yeah, 2017. Sorry, I misspoke.
That's okay.
For humanity and the Earth. And Mr. Kling's analysis shows that by 2017, humanity with a transformed consciousness and DNA is on a positive timeline. So you have, you know, all of a sudden you begin to have a lot of people converging around the same dates, around the same things. I began to interview members of regional galactic governance councils around 2010, like a regional galactic governance council here in our galaxy, composed of the Pleiadians, the Alpha Centaurians, and others who also gave these dates that, you know, between 2014, 2015, 2016, there would be a lot of changes, a collapse of the old order, an emergence of the new, more humane system. They would have the positive ETs taking a, you know, a really active role in our environment. Then again, with other galactic, with other regional galactic governance councils that I interviewed as an exopolitical analyst, one always has to interview. Interdimensional information tends to get corrupted as it comes down through the dimensions. So you always have to verify it. But you can go to exopolitics.com. On the right-hand menu, there's a link called Galactic Governance. If you click on that, you'll see a lot of information there about what's going to happen from 2013 through 2017 through 2025. I myself am projecting that we'll be able to land by 2025 where we are landing a condition of paradise on Earth in Christ consciousness on this planet. So as an objective reality, that is, we're in unity consciousness and we've moved totally out of dualistic consciousness, which is I win, you lose, which has been the ruling consciousness of the elite of the Illuminati, of the Anunnaki Illuminati exploitative hierarchy, in that have been in support of the attempted takeover, dimensional takeover by the Draco Reptilian and Orion Grays. It's all duality consciousness, I win, you lose, rather than the unity consciousness, which is we're all one. And that's essentially what is happening in this universe that we inhabit, one of billions of universes, where now the interdimensional portal, as of late October 2011, is broadcasting waves of unity consciousness. So more and more in this particular universe, which has been plagued by an archonic presence, where we're kind of inside of a flawed universe, more and more it's more difficult for dualistic or archonic enterprises, entities, intentions to flourish. And more unity consciousness is flourishing, so that I myself now am planning very active agendas for 2017, because I figure that at that point we'll be all way over into that part of the energy shift on the planet, and a lot of the plans that we, the progressive starseeds, have been putting together over the last 40 years can now begin to be implemented planet-wide on the other side of 2017. And what's going to happen between 2013, especially starting in 2014, 2015, 2016, is an attempted rollout of the dark side of the New World Order. They're just going to hit their wall. We'll observe it. You know, hopefully we'll wake up as many people as we can. Those who will choose to just stay in unconsciousness, well, we'll see what will happen to them. It's as yet unknown scientifically if we all shift as a whole, or if there is a stratification. of energy. That's, to me,
what do you think in all that you've seen in the evolution that you've been involved in, and I know you're not a predictor or anything, Alfred, but what's your best gut feeling on what will happen?
Well, I've been writing about this issue now for 40 years, and it, really, this is what I've been writing about, and most especially for the last 5 years. So people can go back and look at what I've written, and I've written, you know, very consistent arguments about the stratification of dimensions, or sort of the gradualist approach. And every day I'm surprised by data on both sides. So I'm not bigger than the universe. Mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. I kind of just observe what's happening and report back. I'm struck both by the degree to which humans overcome duality and they succumb to duality. So, but you know, here we are on July 12th, 2013, and I'm sure that the conditions on December 31st, 2013, is going to be a far different dimension than it is now.
Does humanity vacillate?
I think that we can say, you know, this is a paradox. It's like humanity can be both a wave and a particle. And at the particle level, it could be that our deeper community of souls has said, okay, we've won, we're going to ascend, okay, as a unit. It could be. But in a wave, we go from day to day, and depending on what the dark side throws at us and the universe throws at us, we go from one way to the other. But what's true is that it's that much more difficult for the dualistic side to get humanity off track. Now, I think that currently, North Americans have the most difficult life in a certain way because they're targeted and they are really at the focus of the belly of the beast. And for United Statesers to kind of break out of it over the next 4 to 8 years is going to be a real struggle, in my opinion, because so many people are, there's such a fragmentation of a collective progressive vision moving forward. And there's such a concentration of negativity and negative energies. And there's been such an allowing of satanic and negative energies to overcome the population. I mean, I've interviewed, for example, Jay Parker, who says that there are 34 million satanic Illuminati in the United States alone. And so you're dealing with a really heavy duty population. For those 34 million to really transform at this sense, at this time, and to let go of their addiction to the dark side, to duality and evil and satanic ritual and fear and inflicting harm and fear on others, and a governmental system that supports that, you know, with gang stalking and all of that, I think it's going to be a superhuman element. And I'm sitting here as a dual citizen, an American on the other side of the border, because I'm a Canadian also. And I'm also a five planet Gemini, so I can see both sides really well.
Right.
Is that, look, hey, Americans, you better get your act together, because this is a universal judgment coming down. And I think that the core of America has got to stand up now. It's like Americans are so distracted. I mean, it's like Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, it's like
Right.
It's like sin is a national pastime. It's like it's been raised to like a god, you know, the level of a god, you know, to where it's, that's nothing. And it's a country that's just dancing its soul away. I mean, it's like, is there anything left to that nation there, or is it gone? And I can't tell you that answer. I really can't.
Right.
And today's July 12th, 2013, and I can't tell you that answer.
I hear you, and I've gotten a lot of feedback from people all over the world, literally, Alfred, their view on America. And basically what they say is when Americans get out on the street, I was just having this conversation with two other colleagues today, when Americans get out on the street, like get out in the streets and say no more. Other countries at this point, including Egypt, including Brazil, including Iceland, Greece, other countries believe at this moment in space and time that when Americans get out in the street in droves, it's going to topple the whole thing down. So on the one hand, I think that, you know, you're absolutely correct. Like the distraction and the wake up call is way overdue. On the other side of that coin, though, maybe when by the time we do step out into the streets, you know, the fire was already burning all over the world already for us to take the rest down.
Right. Right.
It's very possible. And that's how the rest of the world that I've been speaking with and have been writing me, that's their view on it. And it's an uncanny view. It gives me goosebumps every time they say it. And I ask them, what do you think the critical moment will be when the Americans will get out in the street? And their answer is when it gets hard enough.
Yeah. So
right. We're not having it hard enough yet.
Well, I use the word, let's have a world spring, you know, the Arab Spring.
Yes.
Let's have a world spring. Enough American, you know, let's have a world spring. I mean, Americans are 5% of the world population. They use 25% of the world resources. Let's have a world spring.
I think it's more power to the people if we do that. And I think a lot of people are starting to catch on. And I think our brothers and sisters that are out in the streets in Egypt and Brazil and all over the world right now, you know, they stand in solidarity with us as we do with them. So I think that you're right. And I think I love that. I think that's such a great way to end the show. Alfred, your book, Exopolitics, Politics, Government, and Law in the Universe, will advertise that book for you I look forward to having another conversation with you in the very near future. It's always about love with you, and you are about unifying. You're a very courageous man, and I'm honored to know you.
Thank you very, very much, and likewise.
Thank you. And again, if you need to get a hold of Alfred or any of the links that we did drop into the chat room today, that'll all be available at The Truth Denied in the article that will coincide with the video of this show. Probably have it out tomorrow, and I'll send it over to you as well, Alfred. I think the word, I love this world spring that you talk about, and I think the game is love. What about you?
Yes, love is the glue that holds the universe together. And there's a science to that. That Dr. Courtney Brown reports that is what his remote viewers got when they started exploring the universe with their remote viewing. That the finding is that love, capital cosmic love, is what holds the universe together, and that God manifests as love. Well, that's a scientific principle.
Wow, God manifests as love. That's amazing.